Kollegas, Senoras y Senores, of course I would like to continue in Spanish, but I do not want to offend your ears, so I will continue in English. Now, I am very happy to have a chance to be with you. I am very proud to join this particular event. I didn't know that there was a sort of celebration, a memory of Alessandro Baratta. Since I already appreciate him very much, I'm very glad to be here at this occasion. A second reason to be very glad to be here is that, as you have already heard, we have been here 1997 only for 24 hours. And we have been impressed so much by your country that we thought we should take the next possibility to come back. And so we have been very glad that we got the invitation by Professor Javier Llobet to come here. And I'm happy and proud to have a chance to talk to you. Now, my topic is challenges of international criminal justice, lessons from The Hague as a judge at the ICTY. Challenges. You know, international criminal justice is a rather young institution, and being so young, of course, it has still problems to find a good fundament and to be strong enough to do what it is expected to do. There are two main challenges which have to be addressed. One challenge is to be recognized at all. And as you know, there are still some countries in the world. One country, as you know, is not far away from Costa Rica to the north, the United States, who still is not able or not willing to join the International Criminal Court. So this is one point, one challenge. The international criminal justice should be recognized by many countries, as many as possible, since we have so many violations of human rights in the world that it would be necessary that the global society, the global community is supporting international criminal justice. Another challenge is, even if we have international criminal courts, how should they work? How should the individual trials be performed? And I am now today talking about this second challenge, the shape and functioning of trials, and I would like to bring in my own experience as a judge at the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, and abbreviated as ICTY. Now, I must say, after several decades of theoretical research in comparative criminal justice, when I finally having to apply it to practice as a judge at the ICTY in The Hague, I had to learn that theory is one thing and practice is another. That is in particular true with regard to the outcome of different procedural models. In theory, I always had expected that various criminal procedures, even in case of considerable differences, in the end will all come down to the same result: finding the accused guilty or not guilty. During my experience at the ICTY, however, I had to realize more and more that the final result of a criminal proceeding may well be different depending on the basic procedural model pursued. While according to the structure and rules of one system, the accused may be found guilty, in another system he may go free. and vice versa. Of course, it will never be possible to prove my assumption of eventually different outcomes in a specific procedural case, as this would require to try the same case in a subsequent procedure, an exercise that would run counter to the double jeopardy principle of ne bis in idem. Nevertheless, the mixed structure of the ICDY procedure, which, as will be seen, allows different practice depending on the more common law or more civil law background and of the judges and parties in a given case, will provide us with ample illustrative material to advantages and disadvantages of certain procedural models. Since it is for the adversarial system of the common law tradition is the prevailing model in international criminal justice, it appears worthwhile to ask whether it is indeed superior to other procedural models as widely contended. At least with regard to international criminal justice, I have great doubts, feeling an urge to express them. Now, what are the common assumptions? What may be personal concerns? When representatives of Anglo-Saxon American common law are to evaluate their basically party-driven rather than judge-led adversarial criminal procedure, you may easily find it characterized as the embodiment of procedural justice. And even more, this appreciation likes to be expressed not without a challenging common connotation of superiority of the adversarial over the other procedural systems, as in particular the so-called inquisitorial model. Without such an unbroken self-esteem, it would hardly be possible to understand the truly missionary effort the procedural model of common law is presently globally proliferated as a seemingly only acceptable one. Perhaps you do not know this, but when many socialist countries in Europe changed the system, the United States tried very hard to press these countries to take over the adversarial system and getting rid of the inquisitorial system. And as you can imagine, it didn't work very well because the legal traditions of many European countries is so different from Anglo-American traditions that they had big problems in practice to perform it. Now, this learning from this experience, it was the question, how would it work in the international criminal tribunals? There, as you may know, the practice is rather adversarial, much more adversarial than inquisitorial. Now, this is a crucial importance since international criminal justice has typically to deal with a more grievous kind of higher complexity and crimes than it is the case with everyday offenses in domestic criminal practice. My deep concern is about this question is motivated not only by theoretically comparative interests, but much more by the political anxiety that the still young international criminal justice may get lost in a way in which it will hardly reach its goal, if it should not even more or less fail. This uneasiness is not without reason, more than by critical voices which accompany the activity of the international criminal tribunals merely from the outside. I feel urged by my own experience as former judge at the ICDY to point out certain objectionable trends which might require some correction. Now, whether and to what extent criminal justice can finally evaluate it as successful critically depends on the objectives it is tasked with and expected to accomplish. As concerns the aims of the ICTY, quite a few of them are pronounced in the preamble of the Rome Statute, some of them in almost emphatic manner. I do not have time to talk too much about this. I just would say that principles like fairness, justice, and the problem of expediency play a rather big role. The statutes and procedural rules of the various international jurisdictions likewise turn out to be differently informative with regard to the essential maxims to be followed in view of the aims to be accomplished. Now, whatever undesired side effects may be connected with this practice at the ICTY, it is not necessary to look for improvements. And if I now will criticize quite a few points of the statute and practice of the ICTY and also in connection with the ICC, you should not see this as a fight against international criminal justice, but as an encouragement to improve it as much as possible. The following considerations shall be a first attempt indeed to this direction. In a first step, it will be necessary to look for some of the cases, the causes, owing to which the duration of ICTY proceedings appear such long. This exploration will be followed by the question whether and to what extent the adversary structure of the procedure may be made responsible for those deficiencies. As far as this turns out to be the case, the question arises whether and to what degree the statute of the ICTY and its procedural structure may be open for changes. If this is possible, to a greater extent than commonly assumed, concluding attention has to be given to desirable measures and procedural changes as well as to potential side effects. Now, my first point is the problem, the length of trials. As you may have written in the newspaper, most of the trials at the ICTY and the same as the ICC take a very long time. This is the case in which I was involved. That was a trial against Nazar Oric. It was a case dealing with Srebrenica. Normally, you hear of Srebrenica, of the massacre which was committed by Serbs against Bosnian Muslims. That was in 1995. But 3 years before, there had already been attacks from the Muslim Bosnian side against Serbian villages and so on. And one of the leading figures in these fights against Serbs was Nazar Oric. And I had been trial judge in the procedure against Nazar Oric. And even if it was a smaller case compared to Milosevic or Karadzic or Mladic, it took more than 2 years to come to a judgment. And the question is, why does it take so long? Perhaps, so I would like to ask for the reasons why the indictments and list of evidence are as broad and long as commonly deplored at the ICTY. Is it merely stubbornness of the office of the prosecutor? You see, one of the challenges was that the indictments are too long, too broad, so they have a lot of counts to be dealt with. And the question is, who is responsible for this, because it takes a very long time. Now, to look for some reasons. First, the more the prosecutor must be afraid that should a count fail or evidence expected to be successful turn out to be insufficient, modifying an indictment and bringing additional evidence is precluded. The more the prosecution will be inclined, if not forced, to frame the indictment as broad and as comprehensive as possible and to present as many witnesses and exhibits as are available. Conversely, the defense will feel impelled to counteract with a correspondingly long list of witnesses and documents. What I want to say is this. If the indictment is made at the ICDY, there's no chance for the prosecutor later perhaps to make an amendment. Or if he offers witnesses and so on, it's very difficult to come up with further witnesses. And for this reason, the prosecutor is doing as much as possible to broaden the indictment as broad as possible, to call a lot of witnesses, to offer a lot of documents. And of course, understandably, the defense is trying to do the same. So we have a load, big load of evidence offered, and it's difficult to have control of it. So the second point is, although these expensive dynamics might be mastered by a stringent relevance regime of the judges, the filtering out of irrelevant evidence will likely succeed only if the trial chamber, as early as practical, rather than leaving it until the final judgment, takes control of what evidence to admit as relevant, or at least gives the parties some guidance as to what it deems to be relevant, and to be sure this should be done with regard to lack of relevance, both for legal or for factual reasons. Now, what I want to say is this. As a judge in the adversarial system, very often you do not know what will be talked about in a certain day. You are sitting there, the parties come in, the prosecutor and the defense counsel, and they start with offering evidence, and sometimes it takes half a day for a judge to find out what is the point they want to prove or to disapprove. And so the judges have no possibility somehow to control or to say the parties, look, it would be much more important to deal with this point and not so much important to deal with another point. And since the parties do not know what the judges may find important, they offer a lot of evidence which, it turns out, will be without any value. So I remember many days where when we were sitting from 9 to 2 o'clock hearing evidence, and at the end of the meeting we asked ourselves, the three judges, now what was important? Sometimes we would say perhaps 5 minutes of our whole morning was really relevant for the case. So there would still be more points to be mentioned. I just give another one. The aforementioned factors leading to lengthy proceedings are exacerbated by the separation of the trial into a prosecution and a defense case. And I will come back to this point a little later. A further point is the system that you have in the prosecution case and the defense case, that first one party will present the evidence, and then you may have a rebuttal by the defense and another rejoinder by the prosecution. If you like, I could also give you some examples for this, but for reason of time, I will just come to the question, what could be done in order to improve this system? After having identified these and perhaps other possible causes for the length of adversarial trials, one could be inclined immediately to look for an appropriate therapy. Yet, if we want to accomplish more than a superficial cure of systems, our diagnosis must rather go a step further in looking for the reasons by which those causes might be conditioned. Even though these factors may be manifold, I think we cannot refuse to see that the main causes for the phenomenon identified previously lie in the adversarial system and or in the manner it has rightly or apparently developed in practice. Again, without pretending to be exhaustive, I draw your attention to two features which appear to be both characteristic of the adversarial system and which may be potential sources for the problems we face. The first point is the proceeding as party-driven rather than judge-led. The basic feature of adversarial system implies that it is, at least in principle, left to the parties what evidence to present, what witnesses and exhibits to introduce, and in what manner and sequence to perform the examination. Thus, the length of the trial substantially depends on what the respective party considers to be relevant for its case, or what may even serve as a platform for influencing the public at large. Furthermore, supported by the adversarial philosophy, the judges should principally refrain from intervening due to considering themselves primarily as arbiters or referees, holding the scales of justice evenly between both sides, as it was once phrased. Thus, party, if not stopped by the opposite side, can exploit its power in presenting evidence largely uncontrolled. That can go as far as to the converse effect that parties can withhold possibly relevant facts from the notice of the judges. No doubt that, at first glance, a non-intervenient judge is welcomed by parties in their longing for power. On the other hand, however, the more incommunicative the judge, the greater the uncertainty of the parties as to what in the minds of the judge might be relevant. Thus, again, the parties will be left unguided and feel seduced into expanding the evidence. Now, without questioning the virtue of so-called judicial restraint in principle, certain peculiarities by which international criminal proceedings stand out from the basic adversary model of domestic criminal justice should be noticed. First, the fundamental distinction of a lay jury system from a bench of professional judges. So you may have the adversarial system. What I want to say is may be good when you have a jury system in domestic cases, which very often are rather small. But at the ICDY, you have professional judges sitting, and some cautions, caveats which would be required in a jury system are not necessary. Another problem is a feature prevailing in the adversarial system is the understanding of the proceeding as the party's case, the success or failure of which is supposed to stay in the responsibility of the parties. so as if the wrong conviction of an innocent or the misguided discharge of a guilty defendant is none of the judge's business. With all due respect for the ostensibly noble superiority of the common law judge, the proposition that an international court should be limited to a mere formal control of the trial, leaving the outcome of the proceeding to the ability and own discretion of the parties, is difficult to reconcile with a bench of professional judges commissioned to decide on extraordinary serious international crimes. As the power and duty to prosecute international crimes are conferred upon the court and not solely upon the parties, judges should blame not only those but themselves as well if they do not having sufficiently ascertained the truth, an accused is wrongly discharged or wrongfully found guilty. Be that as it may be in domestic adversary tradition, the attitude of judicial non-intervention seems to be stubbornly persist, even where the international rules of procedure would allow the judges to step in by asking questions in order the prosecution of further evidence on proprio motu to summon witnesses. Now, what I want to say is here, in the ICDY rules of procedure and evidence, as it is also the case in the ICC rules, the judges would be allowed to ask questions at any time. But the practice of adversarial systems is such that the judges are not supposed to ask questions. So since I had been a judge in Germany, also besides being a professor, I also was a judge. So I was trained to ask questions if I had the feeling as a judge that the truth did not fully come up. The judges at The Hague, coming from adversarial systems, they were very reluctant in asking any questions, which meant that sometimes you had the feeling I did not come to the truth, and that you had to make a judgment, a decision, which was based only on what was presented by the parties. And that was very painful for me to have the feeling there should have been more exploration of the case instead of simply relying what has been presented by the parties. Now, a next point which is a problem in international criminal justice is the separation in prosecution case and defense case. As already mentioned, the adversary trial typically starts with the prosecution presenting the charges and evidence, followed by the defense presenting its discharging evidence. This adversary setting of consecutive prosecution and defense cases is even further prolonged by the fact that each party, each phase begins with the examination in chief by the respective party, followed by the cross-examination through the counterparty, and potentially continued by the re-examination by the first party. It cannot come as a surprise that this confrontative setting can produce undesirable side effects. Only a few of them may be mentioned here. Since the witnesses are called by either one or the other party, the accordingly so-called prosecution witnesses and defense witnesses may from the very beginning feel themselves pushed into a one-sided role. This bias is further strengthened by the party's practice to prepare their own witnesses by way of proving them for their testimony in the trial. Perhaps I should mention that this, what I would call coaching of witnesses by the party, has been forbidden in the ICC. It was practiced in the ICDY, and I was very glad to hear that the ICC would abolish this system. You see, since the witnesses had been prepared by the party, sometimes it happened that a witness, because he had, there was a sort of rehearsal, would give an answer which he had not been asked, because he was trained by the party, and on the other side, a witness became very uneasy if you asked a question he was prepared for. And so this is very detrimental to find the truth if the witnesses feel obliged to the party which is calling it to the case. Now, due to the inherent confrontation which exists in the concept recognizing two opposing parties, the criminal proceeding from the very beginning is considered a fight in which each side wants desperately to win. Thereby, despite all superficial nobility in the formal behavior, a spirit of hostility is brought into the proceeding. In order to guarantee an equality of arms within this fight, the various prosecution and defense stages into which the trial is divided are supported by additional fighting rules for the manner in which the various chief, cross, re, and further examinations may be performed. Even in a simple murder case, it may be difficult to avoid time-consuming repetition where evidence on the same elements is presented in fragments. The situation is worsened, however, if, as it is typical for complex international criminal proceedings, one side has to present its evidence long before the other side without being able to foresee what the later counter-evidence may be, thus forcing this party to come forward with evidence covering as broad a scope as possible. Thus, as well meant this network of rules for guaranteeing equality of arms may be, it is certainly lengthening the proceeding, if not even highly detrimental for those defendants who are not able to handle the complicated procedural rules, who are wealthy not enough to be presented by competent counsel. Now, what I want to say is, by the separation of the prosecution case and defense case, in one of our cases, it happened that the prosecution started with offering its evidence, and this was offered for 3/4 of a year, and then the defense began offering its witnesses or evidence, and then as a judge you had to remember what had been talked about 3/4 of a year before. It was very difficult to really do have hold. It would be much better if one count would be dealt with first by the prosecution and then continued with the defense, instead of having a complete separation of prosecution case and defense case. This complexity is worsened further by certain examination rules, as in particular those regarding leading questions which in the chief, cross, or re-examination may be differently admissible for the defense and must not for, and mostly not for the prosecution. Not only that these and similar rules are indeed very difficult to master and prone to prolong the trial, they may also have a detrimental effect upon the research of truth. If an essential witness is not called by either party, because each of them is afraid of not receiving exclusively favorable answers, then the result may be the mutual blocking of a key witness that might only be deblocked by the judges, provided that they do not feel hindered by the need to preserve the adversarial image of a non-interventionist judge. Just to give an example, in our case, where Nasser Oric was accused of superior responsibility, he was commander of a group of people who had have been accused of raiding Serbian villages and who had been accused of having taken Serbian people as captives and kept them in some sort of a quasi-prison. The question was whether Nasser Oric, as commander, knew or had reason to know that his subordinates would commit war crimes. And since Nasser Oric was very often on the field and not in Srebrenica itself, it was difficult to prove it. And many witnesses would say the only person who would know whether Nasser Oric was aware of what was going on in Srebrenica was the vice commander, Tusonovic. But neither the prosecution nor the defense was willing to call Nasser Tusonovic as a witness, because both sides were afraid that the answer might not be fortunate for them. And so the question was whether the judges should call this important witness. And I can tell you, because there was an official decision, and our trial chamber decided not to call the witness, Judge Ezer, dissenting. So I thought it would be necessary to call this witness, but the other two judges didn't want to do so because it was against adversarial practice. If the parties do not call a witness, the judges should leave it as it is. I was very unhappy about this, and I think perhaps the case would have run different if we had really had knowledge what was going on, because there had been two alternatives. Either Tusonovic would have told Nasser Oric was so busy with in the field that there was no chance to tell him what was going on in Srebrenica, or that he would have told, of course, when he came home, I told him what was happening in Srebrenica. So we had to decide on a fundament which was unclear. And as you know, of course, it goes in dubio pro reo, so it had to be assumed that the defendant did not know what was going on in Srebrenica. Now, the question is, what could be done? And it was always a problem that in the court, many judges thought everything is written down in the statute and in the rules, that it should be adversarial, but that is not true. Because if you look into the statute and in the rules, they are very open. And just a year ago, I had a chance to write an article to make a comparison between the ICDY rules and the ICC rules. So I found out that bodies of law are rather open, so it could be more adversarial or more inquisitorial. But the practice still stays with adversarial. Now, what measures could be taken? And I make in form of a thesis present some ideas. There are three areas which should be addressed. The problem of how can expediency be furthered, then the question of how is it about finding the truth, and the third question, what are maybe other objectives of international criminal justice which should be better preserved. So my first point is measures for the expediency of the proceeding. I think as early as possible, ideally in the course of confirming the indictment, the judge should be empowered and obliged not only to examine whether the charges are sufficiently based on supporting material, but also to make sure that the legal elements and modes of individual criminal responsibility are stated as clearly as possible. This is to enable both the parties and the trial chamber to recognize from the very beginning what is legally relevant to be factually proven, and to limit the witness and exhibit list as well as to control the presentation of evidence in the trialing accordingly. Second, in order to make the parties refrain from submitting an overabundance of witnesses and exhibits at the start of the trial, caused by the fear of being precluded from presenting such evidence later, if expectations with regard to a prior witness or exhibit fail, the parties should, in a more flexible way, be allowed to present additional evidence later on if the need should arise. The same should apply to a more flexible and broader admission of rebuttal and rejoinder evidence. Third, even within one comprehensive indictment with different counts and various events, a concentration in time and effort would be reached if the traditional division between first the whole prosecution case and then the whole defense case would be broken up into various units, each of which could deal with the same count and event immediately from both sides, provided, of course, that the various charges allow for such separation and presentation. Where possible and made use of an agreement by and between the parties, it might even allow interim acquittals by the trial chamber. Fourth, a more active role of the trial chamber, and in particular its presiding judge, is also called for during the trial with regard to the relevance of the evidence to be presented. By the same reasoning, when it comes to the final briefs and the closing arguments, the trial chamber should indicate to the parties what issues they should in particular focus upon. Now, what measures to be taken for ascertaining the truth? That's my fifth point. Expediency of the trial cannot be the only and not even the most important objective of a criminal proceeding. Much more fundamental has to be the ascertainment of truth as precondition of equally genuine and literally true justice. In a civil proceeding that is directed towards more balancing of interests, it may be appropriate to leave it to the parties as to what evidence of truth they might present to or should withhold from the judge. This, however, can hardly be the maxim of criminal proceedings, which are designed to ascertain the guilt and or innocence of a person and the damage done to victims. Therefore, at least in the interest of a comprehensive ascertainment of truth in the area of international criminal justice, the judges should feel obliged to assume a proactive role if they have the feeling that not everything has been said to find the truth. Six, this plea for a more active judge does not necessarily mean that the examination by the parties, as it is the typical privilege in an adversarial system, should instead primarily be put into the hands of the judge, as it is practiced in the continental European tradition. Rather, the primary examination should stay with the parties. Nevertheless, it should at least be more open for inquiries of the judges. As for the rest, point seven, even a change in terminology could contribute to a more adequate understanding of the procedural structure of international criminal justice by characterizing its contradictorial rather than adversarial. Whereas adversarial has an inimical connotation of hostility, contradictorial is merely expressing the manner of elucidating the truth by way of contradiction, including confrontation. In such an understanding of the actors of a criminal proceeding as partners of a dialogue, the prosecution would be better enabled to comprehend itself not as a purely one-sided adversary, determined to win the case by all means, and therefore primarily looking for incriminating facts and evidence. Instead, the prosecution would have to consider itself as an office in terms of the Roman duty-bound officium, which, though in a contradictorial manner, has to search both for incriminating and exonerating factors. And as you may know, because of this bad experience at the ICDY, the ICC statute has changed this. In the ICC, the prosecutor has to search both for incriminating and for exonerating factors. Now, the third field would be positive side effects upon the mission of international criminal justice. Now, point eight, downgrading the adversariality of the proceedings in treating witnesses as witnesses of the court rather than prosecution witnesses, as opposed to defense witnesses, this would more easily avoid projecting the national ethical conflict behind the criminal events in former Yugoslavia into the courtroom, and perhaps from there even fortify this lesson back to the watchful communities at home. If witnesses, instead of being attached and accordingly labeled to one or the other adversary side, could simply understand themselves to be neutral court witnesses in search of truth, this could also be a contribution to promoting reconciliation. Now, this was a problem which we really had. It was very difficult to use the trials as a form of finding a way to reconciliation between these ethnical fights in former Yugoslavia. Because the witnesses came in as bearer of a certain role for their own ethnic group, it was very difficult to convince them to get away from this. Now, point nine, if reconciliation between communities strained by historic cultural tensions is to last and not to be endangered by new untruthful legions, then ascertaining the truth to the best extent possible is not only essential for rendering justice in the individual case, but also for illuminating the basis of controversial historical events. Although judges are not historians, their findings serve as material for historiographical descriptions. In this respect, an international tribunal's obligation to establishing the truth goes certainly well beyond the set of a typical domestic court. And here again would like to say, in our proceeding, quite frequently, one or the other party would offer books by journalists who have been done some research as evidence. And then we found out it was wrong. All these books had been written from a biased side. And so to have formal evidence carried out, this is also contributing to establish truth. I mean, if you imagine going back to German history, that there are still people who would say there was no Holocaust against Jews. If there had been trials with regard to killing Jews in concentration camps, then this would be good evidence to turn down all people who are ignoring or denying these crimes committed by Nazi Germany. Last but not least, if an international criminal tribunal fails, history will not care whether it was due to the rules and structures which left it up to the parties what to present or to withhold, depending on the adversariality, one-sided interest of what may serve best to one's own case. In the judgment of history, it will be the court as a whole, with its judges at the forefront, that will be held responsible for failure or success in performing international criminal justice. Now, when to sum it up, if I brought here quite a lot of criticism to international criminal justice, please do not understand it in terms that it should be abolished. My motto is it should be improved to do its job as it is supposed to do. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias for your attention.